You are listening to The Hero's Journey. I'm Jeff Garvin.
And I'm Dan Zarzana.
Let the journey begin.
Welcome to the show, new listeners and returning fans.
Please consider supporting The Hero's Journey by reviewing us on iTunes, following us on Twitter, or by joining our Patreon community to earn exclusive content and even gain the right to vote on what film or book we'll cover next.
This is episode 13, Braveheart.
Braveheart was released in 1995 by Paramount Pictures, directed and starring Mel Gibson and an international cast, including Sophie Marceau, Patrick McGowan, Brendan Gleeson, and Catherine McCormack. The screenplay was written by Randall Wallace, based on a poem by a Scottish author known as Blind Harry, the first blues man of Scotland.
Oh, wow.
The poem was called The Acts and Deeds of the Illustrious and Valiant Champion Sir William Wallace.
Is that true?
Yeah.
It's based on a poem.
It's based on an epic poem by a Scottish author.
Really?
Yeah.
Because I'd read Randall Wallace had, he was visiting Scotland to kind of investigate his heritage and saw a statue or a bust of William Wallace and hadn't heard of him and started doing research.
Yeah, well, he found this poem and that's what the most of the plot of the movie is based on.
Interesting. I did not see that.
Well, we shall have to remedy that.
Out of 10 Oscar nominations, Braveheart won 5, including Best Picture, Best Director, Best Cinematography, Best Makeup, and Best Sound Editing. Mel Gibson also won the Golden Globe for Best Director.
James Horner was nominated both for an Oscar and for a Golden Globe for his iconic score. He should have won, in my opinion.
It was a good score.
This is such a great
really
score.
Nice.
I love it.
Braveheart's production budget was $72 million, and it made $213 million worldwide. That's kind of modest.
It is.
Or that stat surprised me. I expected this to be a much larger grossing film.
Well, and it only made, like, I think $75 million domestically. So
yeah,
domestically,
it barely broke even.
Yeah.
Exactly. I was big surprise.
Okay, look, I love Braveheart so much.
Yeah.
And I loved it even more after rewatching it. Very few of the movies that we've covered that I remembered loving have I loved more.
you didn't have an experience like I had with The Rock.
Right.
Or like, wow, this movie has warts.
Right. I did not have that experience. I loved it. And there's something about swords and accents. And I keep forgetting how much
swords and that, ladies. That is the key to Jeff Garvin's heart. Swords and accents.
A sword and an accent. Mm. But there's something, and I also had forgotten, there's something about Mel Gibson's acting that I absolutely love. He's incredibly subtle when he needs to be, and he overpowers the role with his personality at other points, and it just totally works. And I just love him in this movie. So look, I know that we have to address how this is one of the most historically inaccurate pictures of its time, but I love it anyway.
Yeah, it's, you know, apparently in Scottish history, Braveheart actually referred to Robert the Bruce, not Sir William.
Yeah, I know that.
Scots didn't wear belted plaids until the 16th century. They looked nothing like the costumes in
okay,
the movie.
Okay, but it's...
The hair, the face paint was 1,000 years too late, kilts were 500 years too early, and they left out the bridge from the Battle of Stirling Bridge.
Okay, I know, but
and the Princess Isabel was 3 years old when the Battle of Falkirk happened, so probably not so much with that romantic B plot. At least I hope not.
Why do you hate?
Because then that makes William Wallace a pederast.
Why do you want me to be sad?
I don't.
For a more complete indictment of Braveheart's historical crimes, I recommend to you my wife's favorite podcast, The Rex Factor. These guys detail and rate all the rulers of European history by, I think, 4 or 5 attributes, including The Rex Factor, which is how kingly or rulerly were they. It's a really fun podcast. They did a whole episode on William Wallace, which I'll link to in the show notes, even though it makes me sad and Dan makes me sad. And I'm sad.
Stop. Man, is that you or the wine of bagpipes?
I smell the grass of the Highlands.
They can take our lives, but they'll never take our podcast! Jeff, can we agree that that's probably the last Scottish accent that either one of us will attempt?
No.
Okay. All right, let's start Braveheart. Act 1. begins with the world of common day, where we see our main character in their status quo normal life. At the end of the 13th century, Scotland is engaged in a struggle for independence from England. Scottish nobles are lured into a trap by the promise of peace talks and are murdered by the soldiers of King Edward I. Witness to this butchery is William Wallace, the 8-year-old son of mud farmer Malcolm Wallace.
Mud farmer.
Malcolm himself and his older son, John.
Everyone is so filthy, especially at the top of this movie. The children
are just... They talk about being farmers. I see no crops anywhere.
They are caked.
It's just mud. Yeah. Constant mud.
He's a mud farmer.
So Malcolm and John join a group of farmers who vow to fight against the English. Both are killed in battle, leaving William an orphan. And I think that is...
Oh, wow, you're calling that...
That establishes the world of common day.
You're calling that end of common day. Interesting. All right.
Would you take it further, or did I take it too far in your mind?
I would take it farther.
Okay.
So, well, it's interesting because...
Let me say, I struggled with Act 1 tremendously.
Really? Well, it's that prologue.
I think so. There are two points in this film where I thought could have been legitimate calls to adventure, and maybe there are two... Or maybe it's a two-part call to adventure, but we'll get to there. But
as I was analyzing this movie, I was reminded why it's important to use the hero's journey as a lens and not as a template. Because there are elements of these functions. There are elements of these motifs. And they're not, as we've said many times, they're not always in order.
Right.
But they're also not always singular. And I have to keep reminding myself that Campbell looked for commonalities in every culture. And these are the ones he came up with. So anyway.
Yeah.
That's just to say, sometimes on this podcast, we get really nitty gritty about every part of the movie has to fit into one form or the other. And we always want to cover all the plot. So maybe we can give ourselves a little permission to be less minutely zoomed in on this.
Maybe
one.
Because the film is so horribly historically inaccurate. Right. Maybe we can allow ourselves some creative licenses as well as we go through this.
Fair enough. So I agree that the prologue is problematic because there's a call to adventure in the prologue, and then there's call to adventures.
Yeah.
How
far would you take?
I think you nailed it. The only other thing I would include was that the English had instituted the right of prima nocte, which is they give the Lord's permission to claim sexual rights to any bride on her wedding night.
Right.
That's which, part of the...
according to my research, they didn't actually
There's no evidence. England. There's no evidence whatsoever.
France, it occurred, but there's no statements that it ever happened in England or Scotland.
But they did a great job of taking real historical figures and assembling a great Hollywood epic story around it.
Yeah, as a fictional story loosely based on real events, this is a great, fun film.
I forgot to mention the other part of the world of common day that I think it's important to establish is that William is in love with a woman named Murren, a village girl. And we see that in the prologue. She gives him the flower at his father's funeral.
Correct.
And then we see it again when he returns 20 years later, even though he's clearly 40 years older.
Well, I mean, to Mel Gibson's credit, he himself said, I'm too old to play this role. I don't want to do it. And the studio said, no, we're not bankrolling the film unless you star. So he was kind of up against the wall. Either make the movie and star in it or just walk away.
Fair enough. So that I think that's an important part of the world of common day, is that pre-existing romance, which brings us to call to adventure. The hero is presented with the challenge, which renders him unable to continue living in the comfort of the ordinary world. Campbell, one of the village leaders, invites William Wallace to a meeting. I see that as the initial call to adventure. It's the invitation for William to step into a leadership role, to step into the realm of defying the English. And then there's one other moment in that same scene. McClanna, Murren's father, tells Wallace if he can stay out of trouble, he can court his daughter. So here are these two opposing challenges. Come to war with us, essentially, or avoid war, be at peace, and you can court my daughter.
Exactly.
That's the call to adventure.
Yeah, that's one of the two that I saw, and probably the stronger of the two.
Okay.
When I was thinking about it, I waffled between that and immediately following the funeral for William's father and brother, his uncle Argyle, played by Brian Cox, rides up and he says that he's going to take custody of William, which starts William on his educational adventure, which we don't even see in this film. It completely takes place off screen.
Right.
But Uncle Argyle turns William into the man that he is.
Agree.
Highly educated. He speaks multiple languages.
Yeah.
He's seen much of the world, or at least much of Europe. And he returns to Scotland an educated man, not just a mud farmer.
Yeah. Agreed.
That was a potential call to adventure, but I agree with you that the two... Yeah, I agree with you. Moving on.
I love it when you fight to agree with me.
Oh, God. So, refusal of the call. See, my refusal of the call, I wrote based on Uncle Argyle's come with me and I'll show you the ways of the Force statement when William says that he doesn't want to leave Scotland. Mm. There's also, from your perspective, William marries Murren in secret so that he doesn't have to share her with the local lord on the first night of the wedding.
Hmm.
I think that is stepping into crossing the threshold, though, potentially.
I agree with that.
So, refusal of the call, I'm not really seeing one from William.
I see two.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. Campbell says, come to the meeting, and William says no.
Oh, right. Oh, exactly. I came back to raise a family, yeah. and if I can live in peace, I will. Absolutely.
And then I see one other later refusal of the call, so we're skipping some plot here, but after Wallace and his friends have risen up and killed the magistrate and have gathered and realized, oh my God, we just defied the English, the MacGregors come from the next clan over and they say, you know, we came over because we didn't want you to think you were going to have fun without us.
Right.
And William says, go home. Yeah. Some of us are in this. He tries to, again, shed the mantle or refuse the mantle of leader. He says, go home and deal with yourself. And the MacGregors are like, no way. Yeah. We're going to do this.
Yeah, good point. Excellent.
So that brings us to meeting with the mentor. The hero receives counsel on how to operate in the special world. Campbell called this supernatural aid, the unexpected assistance that comes to one who has undertaken his proper adventure. My acting teacher used to say, be bold and mighty forces will come to your aid. I love that quote.
Wow.
So as the prologue shows, Wallace appears to have been born with the courage to fight. Like right from the top, he tells Dad, I want to go to the meeting.
Yeah.
And that actor who plays young William Wallace has such a great, legit Scottish accent. I want to go.
I can fight.
Yeah, stay home or you'll find the back of my hand. So it's a great scene. From the top, he wants to go with Dad to the meeting. Yep. And he says,
I can fight.
I know you can fight. But it's our wits that make us men.
Yep. That's one of the first mentor scenes in the film. And then later, in a dream sequence, his father gives him more mentorship from beyond the grave in this short, perfectly executed dream sequence. There's so few good dream sequences in film, and this film has several. His father says,
your heart is free. Have the courage to follow it.
And then later, a brilliant Brian Cox as Uncle Argyle. They're watching the Pipers play some kind of dirge to commemorate the death of William Wallace's father. And William is looking at the sword, his father's sword. He's looking at it.
Yep.
And Uncle Argyle says,
first, learn to use this. Then I'll teach you to use this.
It's such a great...
Yeah. So the first this being William's head.
Right. His heed. So the supernatural aid is the training he gets to balance brains and brawn. And to me, brains versus brawn is one of the central themes of this film. And I think they come out pretty even. It seems to me Randall Wallace and Mel Gibson are saying you need both to win a war.
Yeah. And I think because Malcolm Wallace and Argyle Wallace both tell William, use your head first and then fight. I think that was probably a lesson their father taught them.
It's a great conversation about masculinity and how it's not all just browbeating and sword waving, but you have to use your frickin' head.
Yep.
And I loved that.
The final segment of Act One is crossing the first threshold. The hero must pass a barrier to enter the special world. This crossing represents the hero's commitment to taking on the adventure. So, if William's adventure is the fight against the English, I think his crossing is represented by his avenging the murder of Murren.
Totally agree.
When he and his fellow villagers attack the local magistrate's soldiers, that puts them in it now.
Yes. He's committed now.
Right.
There's no escape.
And the whole rest of the film is a revenge story.
Yeah.
It is inspiring even to Princess Isabel from France, who is married to the effeminate Edward II, heir to the throne of England.
Mm-hmm.
She is inspired by this story that her handmaid... Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Handmaid's Tale again. She is inspired by this story that her handmaid, Nicolette, tells her about William Wallace and how he fights to avenge his wife.
I totally agree that's the crossing of the threshold. So. I have one other thing that I think is part of the crossing, which is the secret wedding itself.
Yes. Yeah.
It's an act of defiance.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to let you have my wife on our first night.
Right.
Agreed. Wedding and then killing that magistrate is crossing that threshold.
That is the end of Act One. Of Braveheart.
Braveheart. Let's take a wee break.
So bad.
And when we come back, we'll have Act Two. Dan, what are you reading? What are you watching? And what are you playing?
I read Carrie this month. I'd never read Carrie.
Ooh. The Stephen King debut novel.
Yes. My wife gave me a nice big bookcase for my birthday, and I built it and suddenly had room for our Stephen King collection. So I dug all of that out of storage and displayed it all, and then started counting how many of those books I haven't read yet, which was most of them. I've read like 16 of them. I haven't read 16 of any other author's work.
Yeah.
But I decided if I'm going to read them all, I'd start with the beginning. So I picked up Carrie.
What'd you think?
I enjoyed it. It was interesting to see his first work. Now that I've read so much of his recent stuff or his middle career work, it's interesting to see where he started. Still great at character from book one. He was always excellent at creating an interesting cast.
I want to throw something at you that may derail your train of thought about Carrie.
Okay.
I love that book.
Yeah.
If that book were written today, it would be a YA novel. It'd be a YA horror novel. It's about coming of age. It's about defying your parents' ideals. Uh-huh. It's about bullying.
Yeah.
Stephen King started in
and
YA.
And mass murder.
I'm claiming him as a YA author.
No,
yes.
No.
Stand By Me, The Body, YA novel. It... YA novel.
What?
He has always been, actually middle grade. It would be a middle grade horror. Obviously, the content is upset. But he's, my point is, other than my outrageous claims, my point is he's always been interested in coming of age. And Carrie is the beginning of that.
And then the second book that I read last month was the second Angus Watson West of West novel, The Land You Never Leave. I listened to it on Audible, of course, because I loved Sean Barrett's narration of the first book, You Die When You Die. This book was just as good, just as fun. Sean Barrett is just as awesome. I loved it.
I'll put that on my list. I don't know how I missed
Absolutely
that.
Absolutely loved it.
I don't know how I missed the release of that novel because I put him on my Goodreads.
Yeah, I don't know because you're the one who sent me the link. So,
of the new book?
Yeah
but before it came out, like pre-order, it's coming out.
No, when it was available.
Wow.
Audible, the day it was available, you sent me the link.
This will come clear when I talk about what I've read. So, please continue.
And as for watching, playing, I didn't really do much of anything else. My day job has been brutal lately. Lots of 12 to 14 hour days. So, I had enough time to read Carrie, which is 199 pages in a month. So, what about you?
I did not finish a single book since the last time we recorded a podcast.
Wow, we both failed.
Nothing. I started a murder mystery by Alex Horowitz called The Word is Murder, and the first 8 pages are delightful, and I can't wait to finish it. Then I've listened to the better part of an audiobook called Sapiens. It's a history of humanity from the beginning of our species.
Okay.
And the first half of it is so interesting and compelling. And the last half of it is the reason why I failed history, which is dates and statistics go right through my head.
Yeah.
And so I'm struggling to finish that. But what I have been listening to is Dan turned me on to a podcast called Critical Role. based on, well, it is essentially the audio version of the Twitch series Critical Role by Geek and Sundry, which is six voice actors playing Dungeons and Dragons.
Eight
voice actors playing Dungeons and Dragons. I never thought
and
I would.
And they're so good.
Oh my God. I never thought I would enjoy listening to other people play Dungeons and Dragons. Right. You've been praising this series since the beginning.
For years.
And I never was interested. I was like, all right, I'll listen. And I'm like 13 episodes in, which is like 40 hours. So yeah. I haven't listened to any audiobooks or read anything, but I've listened to 40 hours of other people playing Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah. The DM, Matt Mercer, is my spirit animal.
Yeah.
And he has been such an inspiration to me as I DM for our group. And I'm really excited, especially now that we're starting to get that group going again.
Yeah, so I was going to say, on the playing front, I've been rereading the rules of 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons because we're getting ready to pick up our campaign that essentially died when we started this podcast.
Because of this podcast,
Our friend Curtis moved out of town. TV's Curtis Anderson. Follow him on Twitter, at Curtis Anderson.
Name drop.
We've played one game since he left.
And God's bless Scott and Dean for being so patient.
Yeah, they were patient. But I finally got sick of not playing. I really missed playing, so yeah. I can't wait to do that.
I have played more Skyrim in the last year since we stopped playing Dungeons & Dragons just to get my fantasy fix.
Yeah.
So yeah, I missed it too.
All right. Dan and I are going to write down our deal or ordeal cards.
Oh, yes.
And then we'll continue with Act 2. At the top of Act 2, we have tests, allies, and enemies, aka the Road of Trials. Now in the special world, our hero makes allies, meets enemies, and must pass a series of tests to prove his worthiness. So the allies in this film, I think, are fairly straightforward. You got Hamish, you got Campbell, Flanagan, McClanna, and all the Scots of the village. And of course, Stephen the Irishman.
I love him.
Played brilliantly by David O'Hara.
Yeah, yeah.
And Merrin from Beyond the Grave.
Right. And the Princess of Wales.
Yes. Oh, I left her out of my list. What the hell is wrong with me?
I don't know.
The Princess of Wales.
I don't know.
Isabel.
And you know who we've both left out?
No.
Robert the Bruce. But I think it was intentional.
I haven't left him out.
He's a shapeshifter.
I haven't left him out.
Okay, sorry.
We have the enemies. The English, Longshanks, his army, and his magistrates. Mm-hmm. Also, I guess we could call the leper Robert the Bruce's father.
Robert the Bruce the Elder.
He would also fall under this massive category in this movie of shapeshifters. You got the Scottish nobles, Robert the Bruce, Mornay, Lachlan, and Craig, who are all shapeshifters.
Yes.
And at different various times and in different quantities and to different extents.
Right.
Okay, tests is where things start to get rocky because where do tests end and where does approach begin, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm going to start.
I think this one is pretty clear.
Oh, do you?
This one's clear cut.
I don't think so. I think you and I are going to disagree. I think you think this is clear cut and you and I are going to disagree. So I'm going to name my tests.
Don't be wrong.
And then we've already recorded our deal or ordeal cards. So we had to do that before Act 2 because it always becomes obvious, right? So I would say the first test is that disguised as British soldiers, Wallace and company raid the fort of Lord Bottoms. And Morrison, whose wife was taken on her wedding night by the Lord, kills Lord Bottoms. And Wallace tells the other Brits to return to England and tell their king that Scotland is free.
Yes.
The second test, Longshanks sends soldiers to quash the uprising, but Wallace and company ambush them from atop a cliff and win the day. I still think this is in tests. You flag me when I start bleeding into your approach. Uh-huh. An infiltrator tries to kill William Wallace, but is foiled by his ally, Stephen the Irishman.
Yep.
And then
he wasn't right in the head.
I loved Stephen. I think he was my favorite side character.
He's great.
He's so great in this movie. A little touch of Robin Williams in him. Some of his facial expressions. Little Robin Williams there.
Oh, we're gonna kill the Englishman.
What was that?
No, as Longshanks.
That was great.
Runners come to announce that the English are marching towards Stirling. The nobles won't commit, but thousands of Highlanders are gathering for battle, which leads me to the final test, the Battle of Stirling.
Correct.
Oh, we agree! Wow. So thousands of Scotsmen are gathered on the battlefield in Stirling, including the nobles, Lachlan, Morney, and Craig, which leads us to believe that they're on the right side. And this is inarguably one of the best epic battle scenes in film history. So violent. So gripping.
This is the first... This movie came out in 95. Braveheart was the first film that I had seen that had battle scenes like this.
Yeah.
You're seeing dismemberment and that kind of thing happen, like, on screen. There's not, like, a cutaway, like, just as the sword hits the arm. It's...
Right.
I was like, oh, my God. Like, how did they do all this?
And the horses, the way it looks like the horses are being speared.
Right.
The effects are incredible.
Right.
And they're not incredible for, wow, they're doing something that you can't imagine, like in The Matrix.
Yeah, it's, yeah, yeah.
How do you make it look like a horse is landing on a spear?
On a 14-foot spear. Exactly.
Mel Gibson really shows off his directorial muscle here. Mm-hmm. This is such a complex sequence. Hundreds and hundreds of shots that have to make sense with one another. Oh, another note in this scene. Peter Mullen plays the veteran.
I didn't come here to fight so they could own more lands. Did I have to work for them?
Nor me.
All right, lads! I'm not dying for these bastards! Let's go home!
He was Yaxley in Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows. I'm watching this going... I know that actor.
Yeah, yeah.
Also in this film are Harry Potter vets Brendan Gleeson, who plays Haymitch and Mad-Eye Moody, and David O'Hara, who plays Runcorn. After much bashing of heads and rending of limbs, the Scots defeat the English at Stirling, and Wallace is knighted by the Scottish nobles.
And during the knighting ceremony, the Baliol clan approach William and ask for his endorsement of... their right to the throne.
Yeah.
And that starts a shouting match between them and the other nobles. And William just walks away. He's so disappointed.
And that's the great quote where he says,
"There's a difference between us. You think the people of this country exist to provide you with position. I think your position exists to provide those people with freedom. And I go to make sure that they have it."
And the end of that is William challenges Robert the Bruce to lead.
That performance, Robert the Bruce, is one of the most memorable in the film to me. His eyes are so soulful, and he's so desperate to make a difference and be important, but he's part of this long family line of people who didn't upset the cart.
Right.
Did you know Braveheart 2 is in development?
What?
Yep. Braveheart 2, Lions of the North, and it's about Robert the Bruce leading the Scottish to victory.
Interesting.
And I'll have more details about that later in the podcast. Do we both agree that's the end of tests?
Yeah.
No way!
I think we're...
You're better, because I was for sure we were going to clash. That's amazing.
All right, so that brings us to Approach to the Inmost Cave, where the hero reaches the edge of a dangerous place where the object of his quest is hidden. William's next conquest is the sacking of York, the English town that has been the launching point for every invasion of Scotland. At his knighting ceremony, as William exits, he says, "I'm going to invade England." He is claiming he's going to march right into the lion's den, the inmost cave.
Agreed.
And the sacking of York is the first step.
First time he enters enemy territory.
Exactly. After the sacking of York, I think there's a little bit of a meeting with the goddess moment.
Hmm.
William is sleeping, and he has a dream of Merin.
I'm dreaming.
Yes, you are. And you must wake.
I don't want to wake. I want to stay here with you.
And I with you. But you must wake now. Wake up, William. Wake up.
Such a heartfelt, beautiful little scene. And then you hear William's allies yelling for William to wake up because men have arrived outside the gates of York bearing the banner of Longshanks himself.
Mm-hmm.
William goes out to meet them. And it turns out that Longshanks has sent Isabel to negotiate.
You've kind of glossed over a scene that I really want to highlight. It was a great scene for Longshanks when the prince's boyfriend gets sassy with the king. Like, the, You know, the sassy. King walks in. He gets the king walks in and is like, yeah. "What have you been doing while I've been gone? You've done nothing."
Yeah, our Northern Army has been annihilated.
Yes, and routed. And the prince says, "Well, I conscripted. I'm, but." And then his boyfriend steps forward and says,
"I am skilled in the arts of war and military tactics, sire."
And yeah. Longshanks says, "Who is this person who speaks to me as if I need?" And then throws him out the window.
Yep.
"Tell me, what advice would you offer on the present situation?"
Patrick McGowan is such a great villain.
Yes, he's excellent in that.
And he's so maniacal and and methodical. And the other thing is that...
brutal.
So he has to build this arc that Longshanks is getting sick. And in this one scene, he just has this subtle cough.
Yes.
And then there's only two more scenes before he's deathly ill. He builds that arc. That's really hard to do as an actor. It's not an obvious thing. Mm-hmm. It's little subtle things and then he's sick.
Yeah. And during this scene, a messenger arrives with a basket. And inside the basket is the head of the former governor of York, the nephew of Longshanks. After Philip is tossed out the window and Edward feebly tries to attack his father.
Yeah.
Longshanks is sitting there at the table and he's like,
"I shall offer a truce and pie him off. Who will go to him? Not I. If I fell under the sword of that murderer, it might be my head in a basket. Not my gentle son. The mere sight of him would only encourage an enemy to take over the whole country. Whom do I send?"
And so he sends Isabel.
The princess meets Wallace in York and delivers Longshanks' message of peace. And Wallace...
And a treasury.
And Wallace, whose function seems to be to inspire everyone, he inspires Robert the Bruce. He has this moment with Isabel. Instead of just refusing, he inspires her.
Right.
Says, "I see Murren's strength in you.
Yeah.
You're going to be a queen someday."
Yep, and you have to open your eyes.
And she's just, I mean, he's just turns every conflict into either a blood spree or inspiration.
It's obvious that the two of them are taken by each other.
Oh, major friction or major heat.
Yep.
Anyway, this is a lot of plot, but Longshanks reveals after the princess returns that he's already launched a multi-front assault.
Right.
And so Isabel sends Nicolette to warn Wallace,
right,
and he rides north to Edinburgh to rally the nobles. And Robert the Bruce, he inspires Robert the Bruce to unite the clan.
Unite the clans.
Unite us.
Unite the clans.
Yeah. That's the end of approach.
I agree.
Yes! So before we move on to ordeal, here's how deal or ordeal works. Before Act 2, Dan and I write down a prediction of what we think the other person is going to name as the ordeal, because it's been such a contested part of the podcast in episodes past.
That's right.
Whoever predicts correctly gets to choose the subject of our next episode. I'm handing my prediction card to Dan. He's handing his to me. I will read his first. Battle of Falkirk, Robert's betrayal. Boom. That is correct. That is what I guessed is the ordeal.
Oh, and for me, you selected the Battle of Stirling.
Yes. Do you want to hear why?
Yeah.
In terms of the movie and the script, it is the central turning point. It happens right in the middle of the movie, running time-wise. And afterwards, there's a great reward seizing the sword.
Oh, that's true.
Right? He wins. He gets knighted.
He's knighted.
That's a total...
He's made the protectorate of Scotland.
That's
yeah.
right. And there's a sequence that you could arguably call Vengeful Forces, which is Longshanks rallies people to go after him.
Sure.
And so it really was a compelling argument, and I struggled over it.
Did you have more?
Well, I was just going to say the reason I decided on Falkirk is because this is a tragedy.
Yes.
With a spiritual upswing. If Wallace had lived to become the ruler of Scotland, then that would have been the ordeal. But because that's not how it goes, Falkirk becomes the prediction of how the ending is going to go. Well, shall we move on to ordeal?
Yeah.
The hero faces the ultimate test, often risking death to overcome his worst fear, sometimes actually appearing to die. At Falkirk, Wallace and his Scots meet Longshanks on the battlefield, and the Scots appear to be winning. They've persuaded the Irish to defect and join them, and they've coated the battlefield with pitch so that when their archers send a volley of fire arrows, the English cavalry burns.
Yes.
But Longshanks has his own plans. He has bribed the Scottish nobles, and they desert the field, and Wallace barely survives as his army is defeated. So there's a woman is the temptress moment here, and it's not a woman. Woman is the temptress is really about the hero's loss of innocence, where he suddenly dawns on him that the world is darker than he thought it was. And to William Wallace, bravery and loyalty and patriotism, that is the great symbol of life. He rides after Longshanks when the battle is done, crazy with bloodlust.
Yeah.
But he's knocked off his horse by a helmeted rider, and it turns out to be Robert the Bruce.
Right.
And so Wallace rips off his helmet, sees that it's Bruce, and instead of continuing his bloodlust and avenging him, he's devastated.
Yes.
He's paralyzed. He can't move. And Bruce hands him over to Stephen, and they escape. But there's this scene where Mel Gibson's performance is so great. He's just...
just dumbfounded.
Cannot believe that one of his Scotsmen, whom he has inspired on several occasions, has betrayed him. He's
devastated. And who at their previous meeting pledged to work with him.
I think at that moment he's just like, well, if that didn't work, what? There's no hope.
Right, exactly. The man that I think is the rightful king of Scotland just turned on me.
Yeah.
We agreed on the ordeal.
What are we going to do? I know. Let's do one more segment and then we'll go drink.
This is one of the most difficult segments for me, for this film.
Yeah.
The ultimate boon, reward, seizing the sword, where having faced his worst fear, the hero seizes the object of his quest.
That's why I was so conflicted about...
Yeah, I don't think that William has seized the object of his quest after the Battle of Falkirk. The Battle of Falkirk is a failure. This isn't an ordeal where... there are heavy casualties and massive challenges, but the heroes prevail anyway.
Right.
This is a loss. I think if there are any rewards to be seized here, one is Robert the Bruce is devastated by his betrayal, his own betrayal of William Wallace.
Men fight for me, because if they do not, I throw them off my land and I starve their wives and their children. Those men who bled the ground red at Falkirk, they fought for William Wallace, and he fights for something that I've never had. And I took it from him when I betrayed him, and I saw it in his face on the battlefield. And it's tearing me apart.
Well, all men betray. All lose heart.
I don't want to lose heart! I want to believe as he does. I will never be on the wrong side again.
His confrontation with William on that battlefield and seeing the reaction, William's reaction, galvanizes Robert the Bruce and wins his loyalty finally. And then I think possibly the second reward is the legend of William Wallace continues to grow and volunteers continue. Despite the loss at Falkirk, Scottish people continue to join William's forces.
There's a great cinematic moment where Wallace is standing on a mountain in the Highlands.
Oh my God, that's
and you have
a beautiful
that massive
shot.
Helicopter shot of him. I think that's the cinematic representation of Wallace as a legend.
Yes.
That his ideals will outlive him.
Right.
It's hard to remember when you're watching a film from 20 years ago.
Yeah.
23 years ago. Those shots... that was a $100,000 day. There were no drones. There were no tiny cameras. You had to hire a helicopter and a Steadicam operator with a massively expensive gimbal to fly. And to get him to that location, I mean, that would have been a massively expensive shot. Whereas now, they would have filmed Mel Gibson in close-up in front of a green screen, and then they would have sent a drone and a stand-in for the wide angle.
Hmm.
That is not what happens in this movie. Well, let's take a break, have a drink.
Yes, sir.
We'll come back with Act 3. Wait, why? Kristen? No, that was Robin Hood that he's in. Wrong period film. We'll be back with Act 3. the real reason for this podcast, drinking.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we have survived two major battles now. I think we've earned a beverage. Go ahead and open that bag there, sir. Sir Jeffrey of Clan Garvin.
That's right. Uh-oh, what's inside here? Oh, two delicious cans of Belhaven Brewery Scottish Ale. Rich, nutty, and smooth. Oh, and there's a castle on the front. I love it already.
Have you had any Belhaven brews before?
I don't think I have.
I've had a few. I discovered them pretty recently, and I really enjoy these beers.
Draft craft ale imported from Dunbar, Scotland.
Yep.
I can't wait to drink this.
Yeah. Belhaven is in Scotland, in Dunbar, as you just said. Their current brewery space is about to celebrate its 300th birthday next year.
They've been brewing beer for 300 years?
At that particular space for 300 years, longer than our country has been alive.
Jesus.
And according to their website, this is Scotland's oldest working brewery.
Wow.
And Belhaven's brewing history dates back to the 12th century, predating William Wallace by 100 years.
His men might have had
this.
I'm going to have to look up where.
Right?
Where is Dunbar in Scotland?
It's on the east coast.
Okay. I can't wait to drink this. It says there are specific instructions. It says chill for 3 hours. Check. Carefully open can. We can do that now. And then pour into a glass.
Wait for head to rise.
Wait for head to rise.
Pour into a glass. Relax, savor with a U, and enjoy.
All right, you ready to crack open your can here, Dan?
Whoa.
Oh, it's got a little...
Yeah, well, they said wait for the head to rise.
It must have a little CO2 canister.
It's got, yeah. Pouring. Oh my God, this is all head.
Maybe we need to wait longer for the head to rise in the can. Maybe that's what it meant. I'm letting mine settle for a minute.
Yeah, I am. This is a very thick, creamy head, though. Look at that. If you like swirl it a little bit, it's like waves in the ocean.
This
the way
is like,
it undulates. That is incredible.
This is like
Look
Guinness.
How thick that is.
Yeah.
Wow. But the beer itself, I'm holding it up to the light. The beer itself is almost like a brass color. Very clear. Jeff, you'll be happy to know there are no particulates.
There's no
massive chunks of yeast.
Oh, yeah, it's cascading, not unlike
Guinness. Oh, look
Guinness.
At that. That is gorgeous.
I haven't even been able to pour the whole thing into my glass.
Yeah.
Oh, it smells amazing.
Pouring into the glass, the head. Have you ever seen a like ocean waves from underneath?
Yes.
That's what it looks like, pouring this beer into this glass. The way the head is collecting and then just roiling.
I wish my microphone were sensitive enough because you can hear it like you've poured a soda into a glass and hear the
Really?
Put your ear up to it. Yeah, listen to it. It's an auditory.
I just stuck my ear in
yeah,
the
glass. Yeah, me
now
too.
I've
my
got,
earlobe
now
has...
I've got beer on my ear.
Ear beer.
Ear beer.
Let's take a damn sip, yeah?
I already did, man.
Oh,
yep.
Oh man. That makes me want to take up sword. And kill some English.
First, learn to use this.
then I'll teach you to drink this. Well, this is delicious. I will say...
Oh, my goodness.
Dan has been slowly trying to get me to like wine, because I just wasn't a wine person. I was a beer person first, and then I got into whiskey, and I've just never been into wine. And it's a problem, because my wife enjoys wine. And so we'll go someplace, and I'll be like, I don't want to drink a glass of wine. So then we don't get a bottle. She's got to order a glass, and I... But the last three, so I've been to two weddings in the last month, and they were serving wine at both weddings. And so I've had like three glasses of wine in a row that I enjoyed.
Wow.
Three in a row. I had a Pinot Noir, I had a Red Zinfandel, and then
You can just say Zinfandel.
Okay, I had a Zinfandel, and then I had a...
Malbec.
Oh, it was a Merlot, actually.
Oh, okay.
And I've, you know, since seeing... Sideways, I've been drilled into my head that Merlot is for peasants, but I enjoyed it very much.
Wow.
But this Scottish ale is excellent.
Isn't it? It's full body.
Yeah.
I mean, after you drink it, after you swallow it, you still feel like it's in your mouth.
And I will say this, the first and second acts of this podcast have gone so quickly that Dan and I are drinking at 10:30 a.m. and I'm loving every minute of it. I literally had a sip of coffee and went straight to ale. That is a good day, my friend.
just like the Highlanders would have done it.
We're going to finish drinking our Bellhaven, and then we're going to do the rest of this podcast. Act 3 begins with me taking another sip of Bellhaven Scottish Ale.
Mm-hmm.
It's really good.
10:30 a.m.
Well, it's 10:45 now.
Oh, good.
Act 3 begins with the road back. The hero is pursued by the vengeful forces he disturbed when he seized the sword. Now, there's some interesting elements in this road back.
Uh-huh.
Wallace becomes the vengeful force.
Exactly.
When he assassinates Mornay and Lachlan.
Yeah.
And man, that scene when so Mornay's having a dream of being assassinated by Wallace. He wakes from the dream.
Yeah.
Looks around, gasps in relief that he's not being assassinated. Then his door bursts open and Wallace rides in on a horse. Rides up on his bed, you know, and then he comes in like a wrecking ball. The shot where that iron ball crushes Mornay's face.
God, exactly.
Again, the effects are stunning.
How? It's not like a fake Mornay head that he smashes. You're looking at Mornay, like, cowering in fear, and the ball, the iron ball, hits him in the head.
So how they used to do that...
What?
How they used to do that would be they'd show a fake ball swinging at an angle where it looks like it's going to hit his head, and then they jump cut to...
Right.
But if that's what they're doing, you don't see the cut.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
Stunning.
This is the first movie I ever saw that had this kind of just brutal violence on screen.
One of the things that makes this not a typical, because this, if you take away some of the heart, this would just be a brutal war movie,
right,
a brutal action movie. But I think the recurring theme of brains over brawn, or brains in addition to brawn, and the love story,
right,
is what keeps it real. Wallace and his men raid more English encampments, setting fires, killing enemy soldiers, adding to Wallace's army. His legend is growing. Mm-hmm. He's becoming a folk hero.
Right.
Longshanks becomes a vengeful force, attempting to quash the rebellion once and for all by sending assassins along with Princess Isabel on a false peace mission. But
well, I don't think Princess Isabel was there. That was a fake envoy. Her carriage was there, but...
Well, but in the next scene is a love scene with her. In that cabin.
Yeah.
So I was going to get to that because he has this love scene with her in like a cabin somewhere, and there are no guards, and it's like, what? Where is that happening and how exactly? Because Longshanks says, we'll send her on a fake mission of peace and it'll be an ambush. So they set up this ambush, and obviously Wallace and company defeat it.
Mm-hmm.
They trap the British, set fire to the building, and I mean, there's the violence in this movie is astounding.
Right.
Gandhi, yeah. He's not.
Burn these guys alive in this.
Oh my God. And these guys have, you know, wives and homes and children, but that's war, I guess. Anyway.
Oh, that's true.
So then the next scene is Craig, one of the Scottish nobles, delivers to Wallace the pledge of Robert the Bruce and invites Wallace to Edinburgh, promising that the nobles will now unite behind him. And then Wallace and Hamish and Stephen are discussing this invitation, and Hamish is like, it's a trap, it's a trap, you're an idiot.
Your dream isn't about freedom, it's about Murren. You're doing this to be a hero because you think she sees you.
I don't think she sees me. I know she does. And your father sees you too.
And in the great Hamish relationship with Wallace, he just punches
just
him in the
him.
Face. I mean, they are brains and brawn. That, you know, Hamish represents loyalty and brute force,
right,
and Wallace represents, you know, intellect and bravery.
This is like the third time Hamish has decked William in the face.
And he's so big. It's like
he's huge.
Wallace arrives in Edinburgh and he's ambushed and beaten. And with the help of Craig, Robert the Bruce's father has betrayed his son and laid a trap for Wallace. The royal magistrate tries to force Wallace to confess to charges of treason,
mm-hmm,
but he refuses and is condemned to purification by pain.
Purification by pain.
Thank you, Catholicism. This is where that great scene happens, where Robert the Bruce confronts his father for the last time, and his father is just, his leprosy is advanced, and his face is swathed in bloody cloth. And Robert is bloody from trying to defend Wallace. And he, you know, confronts his father again. This is really, he's having some daddy issues in this movie. And he says, the father says, in a very Emperor Palpatine moment.
Alas, you know what it means to hate. Now you're ready to be a king.
My hate will die with you.
We see this point of view shot of the door closing on his father, and Mel Gibson admits in the commentary that he stole that shot from The Godfather.
Yeah. Resurrection.
Before you do Resurrection, I have to say this beer is pretty strong. I'm a quarter. What's the ABV on this? I'm a quarter of the way through, and my head is pretty
15.9.
It's only 5.2. I should have eaten something.
There's some peanuts on the counter.
All right. I'll have some peanuts.
Have a peanut.
All right.
Anybody want a peanut?
So Resurrection, where the hero is purified by death.
Purified. Wow.
Either in a literal or symbolic way. In this case, it's literal.
Yikes.
And returns to the land of the living, a changed person. No. No, in this case, does not return to the land of the living.
Well, he does in a symbolic way.
Yeah, that's true. He does. The night before William's execution, Isabel comes to William's cell and pleads with him to pledge allegiance to Longshanks and accept his mercy of a quick death, because she cannot bear the thought of him suffering under torture.
Right.
And he refuses.
If I swear to him, and all that I am is dead already.
Her second attempt is to give him a tincture that will dull his pain at the very least.
Drink this. It will dull your pain.
No, it will numb my wits, and I must have them all. For if I'm senseless or if I wail, then Longshanks will have broken me.
Which I think is just...
That's,
I mean,
balls.
You want to talk about this film being about masculinity.
Right.
This is a man who knows he is about to be brutally tortured, and he wants to have his wits about him so that he can...
This is the brilliance of Randall Wallace's screenplay, because the first mentor moment is, it's our wits that make us men.
Right.
Mm.
Yep, callback.
God, that's good writing.
To ease the princess's own pain and heartache, William agrees to take the tincture. So she pours it into his mouth, they kiss, and as she leaves, he spits it back out.
And I want to do a challenge to our audience. Put
kiss somebody
put
with your mouth.
Put two solid ounces of liquid in your mouth, and then try to do a convincing kiss on someone.
Right.
Wait 3 minutes for them to leave the room, and then spit it out. See if you can do that.
Right. Yeah.
Because I saw a lot of amazing violence in this movie, and that's the part I didn't believe. Like, kiss mm-hmm. me. You could even see his Adam's apple bob as she walks out, and I thought, is that Mel Gibson? Like. Well, anyway,
choking on it, like maybe it started slipping down his throat, and he just regurgitated.
Especially
it back
if
into
it's
his mouth.
If it's a strong medicine, like here, take a full shot of NyQuil, hold it in your mouth, kiss your wife goodnight, set a timer for 45 seconds, and then swallow it. Honey, when I get home, when you hear this podcast, we're going to try that.
Oh wow! All right, good luck, Ami.
In that scene is also the theme of the movie. Which was on the movie poster, which is...
Every man dies. Not every man really lives.
I want to say two things about that moment. One, you rarely get away with stating your theme in dialogue. You rarely get away with it and have it add to the movie. It's usually a want-want moment. And Mel Gibson is brilliant at these moments because he underplays them just the right amount. He is a wild, broad actor when he needs to be. Mm-hmm. And the scene that says it best in this movie is the proposal to Murren, and he gets away with the line, well it's a bit sudden, but right. I mean, that's a callback to it's such an out of movie moment, but he gets away with it. And in this line, he almost throws it away. And that kind of underplaying, to me, is what makes him not just a good actor, but a great actor and a great movie star. And you see a lot of that in the 1990 adaptation of Hamlet that he did, where he has these big dramatic moments.
I haven't seen it.
Oh, man. He has these big dramatic Shakespeare moments, but he also has these moments where he throws away famous Shakespearean lines, and they're brilliant. And by the way... For God's sake, go watch the trailer to Hamlet, the 1990 Hamlet online, because I'll link it in the thing. It is not underplayed. It is the worst trailer I've ever seen. Carmina Burana is bursting underneath a montage of the most melodramatic moments. It's a terrible trailer. It's a wonderful film. You've got to watch that. Take some time and watch that film.
Okay. That evening, Isabel then approaches Longshanks as Longshanks is in his deathbed, and she pleads with him to grant William mercy. He can't speak, but he refuses to even look at her. She looks at him and says,
"Even now, you are incapable of mercy."
And she walks around behind him and then leans down and whispers in his ear so that Prince Edward, who's standing by the window, can't hear. And she tells Edward the Longshanks,
"You see, death comes to us all. But before it comes to you, know this. Your blood dies with you. A child who is not of your line grows in my belly. Your son will not sit long on the throne, I swear it."
It is implied, we know who it is, but right. It is implied that it is William's son. So this, I think, is a moment of resurrection, because William's bloodline will live on through that child. That's one representation.
Can we just linger on that cinematic moment?
Sure.
Mel Gibson hasn't directed that many films, and it's sad because this is an incredible director moment. The way he has Sophie Marceau facing the same direction as Longshanks and sort of bobbing from one side of his head to the other so that we can see Longshanks' eyes and we can see Sophie Marceau's eyes in the same shot as she's whispering to him the thing that will destroy him. Yeah. And he can't respond.
Your bloodline dies with you.
That is such a brilliant directorial choice. It's something you would see in a soap opera where you see, you know, one person looking away over the, and Mel Gibson sells it perfectly. Mm-hmm. And it's so simple when you can avoid editing.
But it also, I think it allows, if I can piggyback on that,
yeah,
it allows Patrick McGoohan an amazing moment. His character has lost the powers of speech, and he is an expressive man.
Right.
And so here you have this man who is incensed about what he is hearing, and he would rage if he could.
Yeah.
But all he can do is sit there, and his eyes are bugging out. His face is red with rage, but he can't talk.
And he
can't say anything. He just sits there choking to death.
And he has.
It's so great.
And it's funny because you can tell he doesn't believe in violence against women, because all of his aggression against Isabel is passive. When he's announcing that he's going to invoke the right of prima nocta, he's locked eyes with Isabel and saying, you know, basically saying, "Oh, yeah, our lords are going to rape the crap out of those Scottish girls."
Jesus.
And he's looking at her like, "Ha, ha, ha. You know, go back to your embroidery." And in this moment, she's like, "Oh, did you want to see what passive aggression is like? Because I'm about to pwn you." Anyway, yes, please continue.
So then the day of William's execution arrives, and this is just a brutal scene. The square is full of commoners who are, it's a bloodthirsty mob.
Yes.
As William is carted up to the platform and undergoes a variety of tortures. And the whole time the magistrate is saying, "Kiss the royal emblem on my robe, ask for mercy, and you'll get it." And man, William is just, he continues his defiance of English rule. It goes on so long that even this bloodthirsty mob begins to cry out for mercy for William.
He inspires the mob.
Exactly.
As he's being tortured.
Exactly. That is such a powerful moment that even when the magistrate says the prisoner wishes to say a word, expecting William to finally ask for mercy.
"The prisoner wishes to say a word."
And even the magistrate is, he's overcome, I guess. I don't know. He's resigned. He's just, so he's not going to cry for mercy. We'll just give it to him.
He's clearly never been beaten by a man whose guts he was tearing out.
Right.
And he just got beaten.
Right. it's such a powerful moment. And I don't know if we know that that's how that happened in reality, but as a cinematic scene, it's very powerful.
The only thing I know about William Wallace is he was tortured and killed publicly and
drawn and quartered.
The parts of his body were sent to the four corners of Scotland as a warning.
One side note, when William Wallace is hanged, when they, the very first element of torture, Mel Gibson actually had himself, there was no support. He was actually hanging from that rope.
What a terrible decision.
It's like, so he's really, like, when you see him there gagging and just choking to death, that, yeah, that's really Mel Gibson choking to death there. I don't, I'm not sure why, you know, he went to that length to do it, but.
The other element of resurrection, of course, in this scene is that Murren reappears
right
in the crowd, and he drops her handkerchief at the end, this handkerchief that's become the symbol of her love and his dedication.
Right.
He sees her. He sees her watching him approving of his sacrifice.
Yes.
And they're reunited in that moment.
That's the closure for William. That tells the audience that he's going to be all right.
I wouldn't be Jeff Garvin if I didn't point out the Christ metaphors in this film. You know, Mel Gibson is clearly a religious man, and there are several moments where he does very open Christ metaphors. And of course, that's about sacrifice for something greater. Right.
Yeah.
Toward the beginning of the film, when he rides into his village and holds up his hands to show that he's unarmed, he looks like Christ on the cross. He's riding his horse and he's got his hands stretched out. And then at the end, he's literally hung on a cross as he's ridden into the square to be tortured, which also happens to happen on a cross. It's like, we get it, Mel, you're religious.
Right.
And then the next thing he directed was Passion of the Christ. Return with the elixir. The hero, having won some precious treasure or reward, or having been disemboweled in front of a crowd, now returns to the ordinary world to share the spoils of battle. Also known as Freedom to Live, which I think is a better title for this segment of the film. Robert the Bruce, the Scottish nobles and their army ride out to accept Longshanks' endorsement of Bruce as the King of Scotland. This is going to be a Robert the Bruce kisses the army's and they say, okay, you're the king.
And this would be the culmination of all of Robert the Elder's efforts.
And Longshanks.
It's the whole reason that Robert the Elder did all of this backdoor negotiating with the English.
Yeah, and Longshanks.
Is so that his son, Robert the Bruce, would be legitimately recognized by the King of England as the King of Scotland.
And Longshanks' plan, too, is to have a puppet so that he can control Scotland. Bruce is about to ride out. And then he pulls out that handkerchief from his bracer and he changes his mind and inspires his army to lead a charge on the British. And he has that great line.
You have bled with Wallace. Now bleed with me.
And the Scots, you can see they're just primed, like, yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We wanted to come out here and kick their ass. And so it's, right. And you can see, and Craig, the guy who plays Craig, is so brilliant. He does this look like, oh,
he's
not
like,
again. Like, really? We're all going to die. And so Hamish pulls out Wallace's sword.
Right.
Because Hamish is a bludgeoning weapon guy. We've never seen him wielding a sword.
Yeah.
He's got axes.
He's hammer man.
Axes and hammers. And he pulls out the sword. And this is a Scottish claymore. It's a heavy two-handed sword, and he hucks it like a dagger, and it spins in the air and lands in the grass. And for the second time, we get this shot of a Scottish claymore sort of wobbling against a blue sky.
Yeah, it's a beautiful shot.
The return with the elixir is Wallace is dead, but his spirit and his ideals live on in Robert the Bruce.
Right.
And there's this great voiceover. So most of the voiceover has been Robert the Bruce this whole movie. We'd realize, oh, this is Robert the Bruce doing the voiceover. And then the final voiceover is William Wallace saying, you know, in 1314, the Patriots of Scotland, starving and outnumbered, fought at the Battle of Bannockburn and won their freedom. In real life, the peace lasted 3 years. And then Edward III won the Battle of Haldane Hill and conquered more of Scotland than his father ever did. So it's... it's like, if you cut the story there, it's a plus. But unfortunately,
That is it for this episode. And Jeff, because I won Deal or Ordeal.
That's right.
I get to choose our next episode. Our next episode will be released in December.
Right.
I think we're going to do 1983's A Christmas Story.
Yes! I love it!
I watch this movie every year on Christmas. When my wife and I are opening our gifts, we always have The Christmas Story on.
I can't wait. If you like what you heard, please subscribe on iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts. Tell your friends and give us a 5-star review on iTunes.
Hey, Jeff. Yeah. We got another 5-star review.
Oh, did we?
Yeah.
Who?
We're up to 32. I don't know who, but we're up to 32.
Awesome.
32 out of 32 5-star reviews.
You could be the 33rd.
Can you be 33? If this show inspires you, informs you, or even just makes you laugh, go to patreon.com/heroesjourney and learn how you can support the show and get cool free stuff.
The Hero's Journey is produced by Jeff Garvin and Dan Zarzana with original music by Taylor Jordan. Thanks to Dean Ethington for designing our logo. And thank you to Bellhaven Brewery for this Scottish ale that we enjoyed during the podcast. At least it didn't have Flexicrap in it.
Oh, Braveheart is copyright 1995, Paramount Pictures.
Please follow us on Twitter at Heroes Podcast. Like us on Facebook.com/Heroes Journey Podcast. And check out our hilarious and informative show notes at HeroesJourneyPodcast.com.
Until next time,
journey on.